Hello, this is Corinna, and I am together with Rachel again for this another segment of Cognitive Gymnastics. And this time we even have a live studio audience that absolutely knows how to enjoy life. Rachel, oh, see.
They're coming closer because they just love this stuff.
Yeah, and the conversation that we wanted to have today is the discomfort of enjoying the discomfort of living. Now, why did we choose this one? And it's intended on the one hand as a joke, and on the other hand as any joke. It does have a kernel of truth in it. So where do we experience discomfort and how can we change that? Let's go from there. Do you have anything to say, Rachel?
No, I have never felt discomfort in my whole entire existence on this planet. Never, ever, ever had it.
Huh. So you are the lucky duck compared to all of us. I've had plenty of discomfort.
by culture, I'm used to living with discomfort from that perspective, and a lot of significance as well, being Jewish, being, you know, whatever, all the history that goes along with being Jewish and hated around the world, and all of that can contribute to discomfort. Being a woman in a very male-dominated society can sometimes feel uncomfortable, this discomfort. And there's, and that's just like the beginning. There's so many. You could look at anything and everything, the color of your skin, your religion, your sex, your age, whether you're tall or short, whether you're really great at receiving income, money, whatever, or not. You create the opposite of that. There's so many ways on this planet that we create a hell of a lot of discomfort. And the thing is, what are we doing with that once we have it? Because, you know, it's not just me or you or whoever on the planet that has this. There's so many of us who have this sense of discomfort being this wrongness in the world. And I think that's really what it boils down to, the sense of wrongness of being in the world.
And actually, I would almost like to add one. I agree with the discomforts that that you listed. There's another one that popped in is body shape.
Oh, yeah.
We, especially as women, but I think it's also similar for men. Are we fitting the social standard of beauty? And if we don't, how uncomfortable are we feeling? And then the other one that I wanted to also address is, if we choose to change, and both you and I are people who are really going for change, what I'm finding initially, it's uncomfortable to sort of get out of this old habitual track into something totally different. And there is a certain discomfort, not just because I really have to pay attention to stay in the new track and not fall back into the old rut, but it's also because it's a completely new set of behaviors and a way of being in the world. There is a rawness to it that feels uncomfortable.
Yeah, I like that word. You said rawness, and it took me a second to catch that you were saying rawness, because the first thing that popped in my head was wrongness, which is often what we've been entrained to on the planet, that if we're not whatever this ideal or this expectation is in the world, then it's some sort of wrongness. And so it boils down to the sense of belonging and being accepted by by whoever it is that we have judged to be the determining authority, you could say, whether it's the media, whether it's, you know, I remember reading 17 magazine when I was 15 and 16 years old, and there's a definite sense of, you know, yeah, beauty, what's considered acceptable, what's considered the pretty girl. I remember, and my daughter, to me anyway, is quite beautiful, and she's got, you know, dark hair and dark eyes, and, you know, is an entirely different kind of a beauty that's her beauty. And I remember when she was 3 or 4 years old, she kept saying, I'd like to look like Barbie. You know, she would play with a Barbie doll that one of the kids from school gave her for her birthday. And that's her ideal of beauty.
Can I just interrupt you?
Yeah.
I find it interesting. I said rawness. And that you hurt or went with wrongness.
Yes. Well, it took me a second, like I said. I did hear click, but it clicked after that first impulse of wrongness.
And it's really, you and I, and there's, I know many others that tend to go to the wrongness of ourselves. We tend to not judge others too much, but we really tear ourselves apart. And yet, what is that rawness? And what for me comes is, how willing are we to be vulnerable? Which leads to that sense of rawness. And how much is vulnerability not something, it's the one hand, vulnerability is not something that is even valued in this society, but how much have we learned to not become vulnerable because we so quickly see ourselves as wrong?
Yeah.
And we don't like to add to that sense of, and that almost painful experience of being wrong.
Yes, it's like our natural default setting. Fault, you know, fault. And the thing is, no, hey, it's our choice. And as a kid, nobody ever mentioned to me. I don't think my parents ever realized, and quite frankly, I'm not sure they even realize it to this day, that we do have a choice. No, just think that life is, and this is where it's cognitive gymnastics, because we've been sold a story that life happens to us, or, well, this is just, you know, you made your bed, now you've got to lie in it. And all sorts of goodies like that that we've been told. The difference is that we're the ones actually choosing and creating and happening life, if we're willing to recognize that we've got that power and that potency to do that.
Yeah, the thing is we have the choice to consciously create, to some extent cognitively create our lives. Even if we do not choose, we still make choices.
Okay.
Because of the way we think about it, because of the decision that we make. A decision is a choice. We're just not aware of us doing that. And as a result, we consider life happening to us.
Yes.
And, you know, I'm looking at it today as is also not making a cognitive choice, is making a choice.
Yes.
I'm abdicating my ability to create.
It's an unconscious choice, and it is a choice at that moment. It could be a choice to stick my hand in my head in the sand, you know, or go la 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 la, you know, whatever. It's a choice. And everything in life, you can either look at it, shine the light of consciousness on it, and then see it for what it is. And oftentimes, it's not nearly the bad and terrible and horrible thing that we've judged it to be before, or determined it to be before. What if what if we could be playing with these things that we've been distracting ourselves with, playing with the distractions and the destructions of life, everywhere that we've been destroying ourselves before, kind of like on autopilot, you could say, mm-hmm. What if something different?
And it's also, what if we let go of judgment? Because how much is the fact that we want to look at something based on the judgment that we have, oh, this is good, therefore I'm willing to look at it. And the other thing is we say, oh, this is bad, so no, I'm not going there. And what if we really, if we can get out of that judgment, would that allow us to even something that we could label from this reality's perspective as bad is actually something positive, something great, because it shows us what we like or what we don't like. And therefore, as a result, we can make a better choice than a different choice the next time.
That creates something, life is more expansive.
Yes.
That creates something that we prefer to have as our experience.
Yeah.
That's actively choosing what we'd like to experience more of in our life.
Yeah, and what would change also if we would start to stop the judgment and look at everything that happens to us as beautiful, could we then also stop the judgment of ourselves and start seeing ourselves as beautiful?
Well, there's an interesting line in a phenomenal book called The How to Become Money Workbook by Gary Douglas. And it's a channeled book. And one of the sections in it, one of the kind of golden nuggets in it is that it says, we come here choosing to experience.
Mm-hmm.
Choose to experience. So it's not that we necessarily choose to experience difficulty, or we choose to experience ease, or we choose to experience, we choose to experience, period, whatever it is.
Yeah.
And then it's up to us. What is it that we're actually choosing to experience? I remember playing with my daughter a couple months ago, and she was talking about some make-believe magical house that she would like to create. And I said, well, what if you could just do this or do that? And she said, but that would be too easy, Mom. That would take all the fun out of it. So how much of what we choose to experience, whatever it is, it could be trauma, it could be drama, it could be, you know, divorce or disease or whatever, distractions, like playing with the distractions of life that we were speaking about, are to kind of up the challenge, you know, level up, whatever it is in this game of life that we're playing, rather than recognizing, oh man, look at all these superpowers I could just activate if I let go of the judgment, if I let go of thinking that this is right or this is wrong. Wow, then this just turns into, look at all these magical apples I could pick out off of this video game. I mean, I'm just thinking video game because the kids were playing so many different ones, but you have these stars and then suddenly you could, you know, run on the subway and, you know, the cop behind you doesn't get you. They play Subway Surf sometimes on the phone. There's all these like magical powers and all these things that give you so much more ease and double up your points and do all this stuff if you let go of the judgment. If you let go of the point of view that it has to be difficult or that it's the challenge is necessarily good.
Yeah, it's that, but it's also just listening to what you said is we have these things in computer games, mm-hmm. where we live in a fantasy world because the real world doesn't allow that.
Yes.
And I think that for me is a premise that on some level takes the fun out of it. And this reality really values the challenge.
Yeah.
No pain, no gain. I mean, that's a very commonly used phrase. And in all honesty, is that true? And B, could it be that it's just plain bullshit?
And what if we were willing to let that bullshit go?
Yeah.
And who knows, maybe it served, like, I don't know, 1,000 years ago or whatever, that no pain, no gain. If you didn't run away from that tiger before it jumped on you.
It might have been painful, yes. That's how we learned.
And do we still have to live our life based on that total adrenaline rush of living our life as a fight or flight? Literally, like running away from all these terrible, difficult things.
But supposedly our brain is hardwired. Therefore, we cannot change that. What are you proposing here?
A radical, radical gym. What if it's not so terrible?
Yeah, it's really, and it's, I mean, I've read it even in mystical stuff, that life is not supposed to be suffering. At what point did we come up with that definition of life? Even in mysticism, life...
I want to, you know, let you know that that point is...
The point is, yeah. So now I have to catch the train again.
And what if that's okay too?
Yeah. I mean, you just deal with it and then get back on the train. But even mysticism talks about life being ease. You know, and what can we do to start changing our mindset that it has to be struggle? We're so caught in, I need to survive, and others need to survive, and I need to help others to survive, instead of let's all thrive.
Yeah. Is that allowed on this planet?
No.
Yeah. Well, there's an interesting kind of duality in the world where it's not about everybody thriving. It's not about the world being a world of abundance, which we know it to be. Look out and look at how nature functions.
Yeah, especially you, where you live.
Abundance. There's always something. You could literally, I'm in Guatemala, and you could spit out a watermelon seed, and within, you know, a few weeks, you're gonna have a watermelon plant just there growing. Mm-hmm. You don't have to worry that much about getting the conditions right. It's abundant. It grows. Yeah. But I remember even living in other places where, you know, if you have a home that you, you know, stop taking care of, nature will start to grow right through everything, or a road that's not regularly paved. There'll be cracks in the road and there'll be plants that are coming through. I was walking with my pup the other day and I noticed a drain, and there was this huge purple tree coming out of the drain. Literally, it will grow forth from everywhere. I was in Israel and walking around, there was barley growing everywhere, like weeds. Mm-hmm. Everywhere was barley. There was rosemary hedges. There were all these, the bounty of nature, literally everywhere, if we're willing to notice it.
And I would even call it more, it's the intensity of life.
Mm.
because what you were talking about is this brought a memory up is years ago, I drove a no longer maintained, and it had probably no longer maintained for several years, a paved road, which was the worst dirt road, worse than any dirt road that I have driven. Because it was so broken up and everywhere stuff was growing and it was eating in from the side. It was just, if you look at the intensity of life, it was just absolutely incredible. And how much are we allowing that intensity? Because don't we have to be in control of things?
Well, aren't we so willing to look at where we're scared of things, the scarcity, that there's scarcity of everything, rather than looking at this intensity of life and the abundance of possibilities that are around? If we fixate on things have to be difficult, then that's exactly what we're going to be seeing. We're going to see whatever it is that our point of view is. Life is just going to hand it back to us on a, for some people on a silver platter, for some people on a disposable plate, but it will keep handing it back depending on what our perspective is, whatever our view is. And I love that. As we see, that's what we're asking for or not asking for.
That's
we're allowed to have or not allowed to have. This is what belonging entails or doesn't. And then that becomes our world and our reality.
And there is also, especially looking at how I have grown up, life is a serious matter.
Well,
it's a serious matter. It's a significant matter. And if you have seriousness and significance as some major points of view, then where does that really allow you the... just the plain joy for the almost for the sake of joy and the ability to laugh at something because it is ridiculous, but because it's significant, it cannot be ridiculous.
Yeah.
Let's get that straight. And so it takes so much of the, it cuts down so much of the intensity and tries to put it in a box. And yes, On the weekend, you can have some fun, if you're even able to have fun after 40 years or 50 years of seriousness. You know? And I can see with myself that it does take some unlearning to really say, oh, wait a second, how much fun could I have here? Or am I willing to recognize how ridiculous this is, or how funny that is, or whatever way, whatever applies in a situation, but really take myself out of that significance and seriousness.
And the thing is, I'd like whoever is watching this to get that it's not anyone making fun of anyone.
No.
Hey, we all have been through and are around people who go through all sorts of difficulties. The thing is, how do you deal with it? Now, when you're like in the midst of the mire and the muck and the, you know, you literally feel like you're being swallowed by quicksand, you don't see anything other than that. When you take a step back and you, it may not be right in that moment, but it can be a little bit later on, or it can be if you train yourself and you use these tools of just even observing what's going on, you can begin to take that little space, that little step back, that little, okay, I don't have to be in the quicksand. What if this was something a little bit different? And you can begin to notice little tiny things that, oh, I could look at it this way. Oh, I could look at it that way. What else is possible here that I haven't ever imagined before? Asking a question and not being in judgment are two huge, huge, huge tools for stepping out of that quicksand. And yet it's this, we have to practice using these tools. We have to practice using this not going into the trauma and drama and going, okay, well, here I am again. What is this? And what can I do with it? It's like a muscle that you build in a way, not from no pain, no gain, but just from this, like, oh my goodness, look, here's a vine. I can pull myself out. Oh, look, there's another vine. I can pull myself out. I don't have to be stuck in whatever this is. So what else is possible?
It's also one thing that I know works really well for me. If I go into the drama or the trauma and of something, is to actually up it. To increase, and then there is a point for me where I see the ridiculousness of it all, and I break out in laughter, and after that, it's almost impossible to go back into the drama or trauma, you know, because you push through it. And it, by... I'm actually accomplishing two things. A, I am the one, even if I subscribe something is happening to me, to up the whole thing, the intensity is something that I'm doing. And then the breaking through also allows me to see that actually the whole trauma and drama was my story, was of my making. And so it becomes easier and easier, and it's the practice than to buy less and less into the trauma and drama.
Yeah.
And to say, oh, okay, there's another one. Oh, I'm stuck in it. And I remember so vividly, you know, moments when I said, damn it, I just want to have 5 minutes of my trauma and drama.
Oh,
but already saying that made it almost impossible to stay in it.
To stay in that. I say that that's not necessarily true for everyone, because I've been, okay, so my parents have been here for the last few weeks. My mother has been here for the last few months, I guess. And so it is so easy when you're around people who are really deep into drama.
Yeah.
And you're surrounded by people who are into drama, you can get pulled into it without even noticing that you're pulled into drama. You just,
yeah.
You know, the empire sucks back. You know, it literally
it's the old rut that you fall into.
Got no idea that you even went headlong into that, but you're there.
Yeah.
And it's great practice as well to recognize, oh my goodness, look at this. I'm in the cesspool again. Wow. And that was like so fast. I can't believe I fell into it this quickly. And it gives you that possibility. I love what you were saying about, you know, making it bigger and indulging in it more and more and making it, you know, more intense and more intense, because you're not resisting it.
Yeah.
And I find that, at least in my case, whenever I'm resisting something, I'm fighting against something, I just make it stronger anyway. It's not like making it go away by resisting it, but I just end up wasting my time and my energy and my capacities in trying to avoid something or to resist something or go la 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 la, rather than just going, okay, so what is this? Let's just bring it up and look at it.
Yeah.
And when I look at it, it just goes away. And if I'd like it to go away even faster, I can just go, okay, well, let's expand this. And I just make it bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And oftentimes it just, whoops, goes away.
Or you say that is that I expand my space. Because if I go into trauma and drama, I'm becoming really small. I'm doing this, you know, in a way. And if I'm willing to just become as big as the universe, then the trauma and drama is a pebble in the ocean. Now, how much is the ocean affected by a pebble? I don't really think a lot.
So. But drop that pebble into a little tiny cup or
pimble or cup, yeah, it splashes over. Exactly. But so it's also it's two ways, so to speak. I can either make myself big, or I can make the situation huge and get through it as a result of that.
It seems to kind of disappear or dissipate, whichever way you do it.
Yeah.
You step into the space of recognizing the gift that we are, just by the immensity and the magnificence and the phenomenons of who we are and how we look at things and how we create our world. A lot of times we're not ready to hear that we create our world or that we're responsible for everything in our lives. Well, it's whatever we create. It doesn't mean that it has to be something negative or bad. It's just as soon as we recognize that we create something, we can also create something different. Because, hey, if we can create A, we can also create B and C and D and E and F and who knows how many other, you know, letter combinations.
And sometimes it's easier to create, to find out what you don't like in order to create what you like.
Yeah.
You know, you say, okay, I don't care for these things. What else is left then? Oh, I could choose something different. So it really is helpful in that arena too.
What's actually really interesting with the topic that we picked today, playing with the distractions of life, is that usually when we speak about the distractions, or we're not looking at them as like happy-go-lucky distractions. They're usually the ones that take all the, like, this oomphness and intensity and all the juice out of our, you know. It's really funny. But we give those, whatever they are, much more power in our life than whatever we are and our capacities and our joy and our exuberance and our way of looking at the world, whatever that is. We give those outside things much more validity than we give ourselves.
Yeah, it's interesting as this is, we're so entrained in a way to give our power away. And I've had a conversation with, yes, the impact that Trump has on people. And I said, you know, Trump is not running my life. I'm making the choices and create my life as a result of that. Or in another context is health. I give the power away to the physician instead of recognizing that being in communion with my body, I can create changes that, make everything a lot easier, that can range from healing stuff right away to creating an easier healing based on an operation that was, or surgery that was necessary. So it's really how much are we willing to own our power. And I also, just looking at the way I grew up, nobody ever told me that I had the power. Mm. It was the power of my parents. So it was external. And then it's the job, it's school, it's, you know, you there's so many things outside of us that we're entrained that have the power over us.
Yeah. It's sacrilegious, really, to say that you have power. I mean, how dare you? Who do you think you are? Was one that quite a lot of. Who do you think you are?
And what if we change? I really like the thoughts that Access Consciousness is using by using potency instead of power, because how much do we associate power with power over somebody or something else, versus potency is ours, within ourself? You know, and yes, ultimately, if we are who we are, we actually influence tremendously the people around us.
Yes.
But it's not from a space of, oh, you need to do what I want you to do.
Well, it's not controlling anyone.
Yeah.
Perhaps inspiring and inviting to something.
Yeah.
But it's telling anybody that you've got the right answer for their life. You're going to be the guru of their reality, and they've got to listen to everything that you say. No, it's this, hey, this works for me. If you'd like to play with it, hey, come along for the ride. So much fun for me. Maybe it'd be fun for you. Here's a great book, Being You, Changing the World. Let's have fun reading it. You know, got any questions? Call me, you know, or whatever the case is.
And the thing is, you know, we talked about judgment and how many modalities are there that do not judge in the format of a sledgehammer.
Yes.
But it's very refined and subtle that the judgments are still present. And it's really still asking to be the guru from whatever the modality is, or whoever came up with the modality. There is still this is the right way to do it. This is the right way to go about it. Even if it's in a very subtle and underhanded way, not underhanded in the sense that they're trying to trick you. It's just, they are not even aware of doing it.
Yeah.
You know, and I really find it, I mean, yes, that's where the discomfort comes in, to realize, oh, shucks. I'm still having this refined judgment, these subtle forms of judgment. And that can be uncomfortable, realizing, because I let go of judgment.
Yes.
I let go of the sledgehammer method.
All stuff that says judgment on it in all capital letters.
Yeah.
For me, the intensity of the judgment is the one that I direct against myself. I've, over the last few years, cared less and less about what other people think of me.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes I still do, but not nearly to the extent that I did a few years ago. But that refined judgment against myself,
yeah,
that's the... For me, the kicker. That's the one that's really...
We're masters at that.
What? My coffee. You can have my coffee. You can be a live studio audience and not have my coffee. Thank you.
But yeah, I want to wake up too.
Yeah.
It's morning. Where's my coffee?
Coffee, but still. See, the fan club has relocated closer. I don't know if you can see them. There we go.
Yeah. So I think we've chatted long enough about it. Do you have any suggestions? And I'll also think if I have any ideas of what we can do or how we can be to just bring more fun, allow more intensity in our lives.
When?
And with intensity, I'm not talking about the adrenaline junkie, that I need to do extreme sports because then I feel alive for a moment and then I go back to
it. Well, you can do extreme sports if it makes your body happy and you enjoy it and it's fun for you. And that's just, you know, that.
But then it's a continuous, ongoing situation.
Yeah. Wow, there's so much for everyone of literally any shape, size, anything. I love to move my body, and now I ain't no skinny mini yet, you know, but I love to move my body. I put on music in the morning, and I'll put on something when I'm brushing my teeth or when I'm getting ready, and I'll just move. My body enjoys movement.
Mm-hmm.
And I will just move whatever it is. And it doesn't have to be like rapid. It could be slow and sensuous and just like, what energy would I like to play with right now? And that's the song that I'll put on, and that's how my body will move. It may move in circles, it may just move, it may, whatever the, but in moving, I've already changed something. There's something that's moving energetically in my body. I'm no longer stuck. So that's one thing that I do. Another thing is I get out in nature, and I often hug trees, or I'll just say hello to the trees as I'm walking past. I'll take my dog for a walk and just enjoy being around the trees and the flowers and hear the birds singing. And that tends to lighten up anything and everything that's going on in my world. Because when I used to act years and years and years and years and years ago, you know, in whenever they'd say, show a person who's really depressed or show a person who's down, that would be, and I remember the years that I was diagnosed as bipolar and I was going to the therapist's office, there was a lot of this contracting, closing in body. So just the sheer moving or going out in nature or just, you know, hey, I'm going to wail my butt when I walk today just because I can. That shifts things and changes things just in and of itself. Another thing that I love to do really is become that space that you were speaking about before, letting all my barriers, my points of views, the way that I look at the world, letting all of that down and going, okay, if I'm melting that into point of view soup and it's just down here, I don't have to be any of those points of views. What else is possible? And I expand myself out. And my favorite question is, what energy, space, and consciousness can my body and I be to not be affected, impacted, or impinged upon by anything that's going on out here? Yeah. And it may not work time number one that I ask it, or time number two, or time number three, but sometime by time number 10, it changes.
It's
our points of views that change everything. So if I change my point of view about something, that something changes.
So, yeah, what I find too is that, you know, one of my, it being spring now, one of my favorite things is in the morning when I really hear the birds.
Oh.
To just sort of cuddle into bed and for a few more moments and just be present with the song of the birds and just connect with the earth. And sometimes that leads to just becoming really large and spreading out over the earth. And being with the earth. So that's really a joyous way for me to start the day, you know. And what I find for myself is the way I do the morning sets the tone for the rest of the day. You know, so if I wake up really joyful, the rest of the day is so much easier. And
great question. Or things that you tap into in the morning as part of your morning?
Yeah, it's just being present and then really having a sense of gratitude for the birds and for their contribution that they are to me in the morning. You know, have a sense of gratitude for the earth that it's there to support me. And even going to having a sense of gratitude for my body. Because, you know, if I would not have a body, there is a lot of things that I could not experience. I could not touch. I could not feel the breeze on my skin. I could not feel the sunshine on me. So there is a necessity for, or not necessity, that's the wrong word. There is a benefit of to having the body because it allows you to experience things that if you would be just ether or energy, you couldn't experience in the same way.
it's interesting when you were speaking about the intensity of living before. It reminded me of that movie. I remember watching it years and years ago. I think it was in the mid 90s or something. It was a black and white movie, or it started in black and white. I think it's called Pleasantville. Something like that. Yes.
Yeah.
The intensity of adding of the color bit by bit was so dangerous at first. But that's the thing. We can get out of the right and wrong of the black and white.
Yeah.
We can begin to see a whole spectrum of possibilities.
Yeah.
When we embrace that, the fullness of living, that joy of living. Mm-hmm. Life is, sometimes it's a very intense game, but it's a game when we're willing to, not take ourselves so seriously.
You know, sometimes I almost have the analogy that life is as if I'm a kid playing in the sandbox and creating some, building something, putting some stuff into it, or even things that I did with my kids where we used all kinds of different toys, from Lego to Playmobil to Brio to, and created cities and landscapes on the living room floor. But on the one hand, that is life, and that's also the ease that life could be if we allow it.
Yeah.
You know? And so it's really, I made a demand of myself to introduce way more fun and intensity and also elegance into my life, you know. And elegance could be as simple or fun, I don't know which category it would fall into, and I don't care. But if I have a cup of coffee in the morning, that instead of just pouring the milk in, I'll foam the milk. You know, it's a minor thing on the one hand, but choosing it is shifting something in the way I go about my life.
Wait. You mean you're living life as a celebration of living? Is that allowed?
No. That is breaking all the rules.
That's, someone's going to kick you off the planet if you do that, especially with the-
I'll wait for that and have fun in the meantime.
Oh, I love that. I love that. It's the little things and enjoying the, it's being present with it. So you foam the milk and you have this delicious coffee and you're actually aware of the deliciousness of the coffee as you're sipping.
I cherish, you know, the sensation of the foamed milk in my mouth. I'm being present with it, and that's also where, you know, a meal can become orgasmic.
Oh, yeah.
Really, what does it take? And it's often really small stuff that we can add to our life that makes a humongous difference. Yeah. I mean, I just notice how my day goes different if I take the 30 seconds to foam the milk.
Yeah. I have several sets of plates, and there was always the, you know, the everyday plates that would break more frequently, but they were like the, you know, the simple plates. And then there were the plates that I really like. And then there's, you know, my grandmother's plates, which we haven't touched in years, really, because we haven't done so much with them here. When the family lived here more, then we would use them more often, but we haven't for a while. But my quote unquote fancy plates are now the plates that I use all the time. Mm-hmm. My family sometimes to use them, sometimes not. But for me, it makes a difference and puts a smile on my face when I use a plate that I love. You know, it changes every meal that I have, even if it's a quick one, into a celebration.
Mm-hmm.
It feels so much better when I place my food on it. When I take a little time for myself, that creates a celebration. When I yeah, when I'm really relishing and really cherishing and really present with the meal or the walk or the sound of the birds or the feel of the sheets, you know, the warm sheets of the bed against my skin.
Or the cool sheets.
I'm alive now, you know, in this moment. This is now. And then when I'm enjoying this, I'm looking forward to creating the future. I'm inviting the future into this now.
Yeah.
This joy. And then what else is possible?
We're also getting more creative. I mean, it has so many repercussions in that sense. And it also invites, at least for me, the question is, so what else can I add to my life? And what else can I create in my life that I enjoy, that I'm not creating because I have to create, or, you know, I'm creating that because I'm running a business. It's, oh, I would have fun. And yeah, I have a business, and if it contributes to the business, great. But it's not so much, you know, what comes first?
Yeah.
You know, is it the business that makes me do something, or is it the joy of living that allows me to create something and that creation contributes to my business?
What if that joy of being is your business?
Joy of living is your business, but life is your business in some way. Yeah. Yeah.
I love that.
So thank you for the conversation.
Thank you. And what a great way to stay. That was fun.
That was fun. And let's figure out when we're doing another one.
I'm sure we're going to eventually move our cognitive gymnastics to maybe some physical gymnastics too.
Who knows where we end up?
Yep. So if anybody who's watching this has an idea or a theme or a topic that they'd like for us to play with, either Corinna or I know, or both, you can
contact the person you know.
Exactly.
Let us know what you're thinking of.
That sounds great.
Yeah. Okay.
Coffees.
Take care, Rachel.